Graduates, parents, special guests, colleagues, welcome. Welcome to the graduating class ceremony for 2019. My name is James Liao. I have the pleasure here of being the head of school. Tonight is a celebration and an important event that signals a change, a transition from high school and student life to the next step of your lives. Graduations are a shared experience, and there are hundreds of thousands of schools around the world at this point in time who are having similar ceremonies to this. And such is the importance of this occasion, that we remember it and we celebrate it. And I'm always interested in the messages that are shared at these events. What could we possibly say that hasn't already been said that we could pass on to you and help guide you into the next phase of your lives? And what I'm also aware of is what's said that might not have the effect that it should, might not have the substance that's intended. And this advice is for people that are asking, no longer what do I need to know, but what am I going to do? And the what am I going to do question is a great one. So the idea of what may we not say, I can always think of three empty buckets, and author David Brooks, calls these the empty boxes. And I prefer to think of them as empty metal buckets kind of clanging around that we're desperately trying to fill all the time. And the first one is the advice to be authentic, right? The advice that, you know, I want to be clear to you, I'm not saying that being authentic isn't important, but it doesn't necessarily provide the direction for people who are trying to answer the question, what am I trying to do? The call to be authentic, the call to awaken the giant within is important, but impossible when we're still being formed. Then there's the advice for autonomy. And I'm going to take a classic TOK moment to say, TOK is typically about that time when we say, it's about you figuring it out. What are your answers? What are your values? You find your own way. But that can be just as uncertain at a time, just as much of an empty bucket. Which brings us to freedom, and I'm a big fan of freedom. Congratulations, you're all free. The liberated self, you're here. The problem is that we can sometimes be drowning in freedom. When what we want is direction, we want freedom, we want to know what we're going to do. And these are your Odyssey years, your years when you're out adventuring. The coming decades should have the best Instagram feeds for you ever, is our hope. Appropriate. This is the time of daring and a time of firsts, a time of yeses. Entrepreneur Blair Miller suggests that these early years need to be a time when you widen your horizons and you risk safely, but you also do a little bit of crazy. Because doing a little bit of crazy is important, because once you understand that you can do crazy, you understand that you can always do crazy, and that you can always survive crazy. And that's a good lesson to learn right now. It's also a time to invest in what clinical psychologist Mags Jules calls your identity capital. You want to do amazing things that you're always going to talk about. You want to do things that make you amazingly interesting people, even more than you are now, which is hard to imagine. When I left university, I am so glad that I didn't just go into teaching. I had a series of crazy jobs. One of them was working with a gentleman named Rick Davis. Rick Davis had a series of bouncy boxing castles that we would set up and inflatable at kids' birthday parties. We used to hire skateboarders to come and help us set them up because they were cheap. Problem is, the kids in the birthday parties would end up watching the kids on the skateboard and not inside the bouncy castle. So Rick Davis, being an entrepreneur, said, let's make money on this. Let's take these skateboarders. And to make a long story short, 3 years later, we had a 40-foot half pipe on a trailer running through every Six Flags amusement park in the United States with all kinds of skateboarders, BMX bike, and inline skaters, one of them being Tony Hawk. I was organizing that from the basement of Rick's house. It was crazy. And I'm so glad that I did it, but I would never want to do it forever. Do crazy. It's not a bad thing. But it's a good start. But it doesn't really allow us to plant ourselves and become. And although 100 experiences are great, it doesn't get us to one experience that we can do with 100% of ourselves. Annie Dillard has a great quote that I love so much. because she reminds us that how we spend our days is how we spend our lives. So let me offer you some ways forward. The first one is hope. I love the word hope, and its close cousin, optimism. Hope is the fire that drives us and fuels us and keeps us going when our plans and dreams don't always work out the way that we want them to, but we believe that they will. I never met my grandmother, but my father always said that she was the eternal optimist. Always glass half full. And apparently, she had a huge cast iron stove that was in the corner of their farmhouse kitchen. And for her, what my dad always said too, was that the fire was always on in that huge oven. Didn't matter if it was the middle of winter, or the middle of summer, or the middle of the day, or the middle of the night, that fire was always going. And I think about that with our hope too. You can always have hope and you can always have optimism, but I need to be clear that hope isn't a direction. You don't do hope. You are hopeful. Which brings me to the second part, which is options and choices. When I finally decided to get a profession and do something with my life beyond looking after Tony Hawk and his skateboard show, one of the things I went to teacher's college and I entered the teaching profession at a terrible time to become a teacher. There was a shortage of kids and too many teachers in Ontario at the time. And in my region, where there was literally 100,000 students, there were only two jobs posted. One was for a 50% cooking teacher, 50% Latin teacher. I have no idea who got that job, but I'd love to meet them. And the other job was for a 100% special education teacher / behavior. I jumped at the opportunity. I went for the job, I went to the interview. The person at the HR office, as I walked in, jumped up so excited that someone had come in for the job. She said, "Really, you want this job?" I said, "Absolutely." That should have been my first clue, I missed it. I went into the interview and she said, "Come this way, interview right now." And I met the gentleman who was in the HR office and he said, "Actually, it's not one job, there's two jobs that you can choose from. The first one is in a prison. The second one is in an old town hall." And I thought, well, I'll apply for the one in the old town hall. Who would ever want to work in a prison? What he didn't tell me was that the old town hall job was the job that kids went to when they left the prison. So instead of living in the security of guards and bars, it was just me and 12 17 to 19 year old boys who were now in open custody. What could possibly go wrong in that situation? And we were in the basement of an old town hall having a great time. And when I say just me, it was literally just me and them. And we did physical education, and we did math, and we did science, and we did English. And the great thing was we had books to read, but we had no ability to read. So we did the next best thing, which is we watched movies. I love the fact that smart people who read also make movies about books, which means we can all brag that we read great books. Don't deny that. I know that's true. The Hobbit, Harry Potter, I won't go on. The point is, we used to watch these movies, and one of the things that I would do is I'd stop the movie halfway through and I'd ask the students, what happens next? And if I ask that question to anyone here or to this community, I'd get dozens of answers. What happens next? You'd come out with crazy things. I'd get hundreds of ideas. You'd come out with exciting, funny, hysterical things that would happen next. There'd be thousands of ideas in this room of diverse, culturally rich, language rich, interesting, life experienced people. The most I ever got from those kids in that old town hall was eight. Eight things that they could think of, and they were really doing their best. And what I learned from them was, the reason they kept getting into trouble over and over again is because they genuinely couldn't think of anything else to do. This is how they reacted to situations. We are so lucky as a community that we have so many options and so many choices, and we can imagine so many different ways forward for us. I survived that. I spent 4 years with them, and it was a great 4 years. And I want to just reiterate that options give us choices, and choices give us power. And Nietzsche describes freedom not as an ocean to be swimming in and to play in, but as a river that needs to be crossed. Freedom is a river that needs to be crossed so that we can get to the other side, plant our flag, commit, and do something. I wish you all the very best for your future. I hope you always keep your fires of hope burning. Imagine great possibilities and learn to commit and learn to connect. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'd like to start with some very important thank yous. Thank you, firstly, to Dan Reynolds for all your work planning graduation this year. And of course, all the support staff, Bruno, Michelle, who else? Lisa Dodson for the programme, so many people involved for making the celebration happen. A massive shout out, and thank you so much for coming, to our class of 2017 and 2018 students. I am wearing my white bands in honour of you today. And finally, thank you to those people who have come to support our graduates, especially to those people who have travelled long distances. Graduation is traditionally an emotional affair, and unfortunately much more so on this particular occasion. Please forgive me if I do not make it through this speech unscathed, but my model has always traditionally been to leave soppy affairs to the end, so I will continue in that vein. Recently, I found a letter which Lucas Malnight Alvarez wrote at the start of this academic year to his future self. In that letter, he gave some brilliant advice, which I personally found useful in this scenario. As he so aptly put it, Lucas, remember, don't cry at graduation, God looks late for the pics. Right, I can show you a picture now. I do believe that I am also looking incredibly slick for the pics this evening. Please do feel free to take them. And so I will attempt to heed his advice and will continue the speech by focusing on our IB graduates. The IB is a truly ferocious and fantastic beast. Thinkers might approach it cautiously. Michael, for example, is likely to ask more questions about the approach than most might. Should I approach from the left or from the right? There are those whose approach is that of a risk taker. Leo Lucina, for example, would dive straight in alignment with his ever so slight competitive nature. However you approach, you should be aware that only the bravest leave with welfare. Before making it to the beast, you'll have to travel west to east. On those travels, you're sure to meet a few shifty characters you'll have to defeat. First, you must survive homeroom with Mr. Petit. Croissants galore can increase belly size exponentially. The issue of food will be difficult to escape, given that Mrs. Hansen's dining room is always filled with cake. Then there's TOK with Dr. Aguilera. Leave with less than an A and you're sure to unsettle. Speaking of TOK, let me say that philosophical debate between students may arise more naturally. Indeed, one day in the common room, debate began to stir. Louis Muget was the one to infer that water is not wet. What, I hear you say? Water isn't wet? How can it be? Just think of the sea. May I advise that you wait until it's raining? Then remind Louis, whilst he's sure to be complaining. Back to the journey. Don't expect the class coordinators to let you pass without quality reflection. Ignore this major aspect and you're sure to get attention. When you get close to the beast, then we come back to the initial question. How do you approach? Should you crack a joke or should you use deception? If you have a sasha, then you could find that banging on the drums helps the beast to unwind. Natasha could amuse it with paper making. Esther could take his legs in a rugby tackle his back ring. Not recently, given his shoulder problem, which is why I don't have a penalty for him. Nico and Felix could draw his attention with a shining smile. Can we see it? Yeah, there we go. And Otto could distract him with his intriguing yawl to have muscles like Clark Kent, Superman style. I will let you imagine that particular picture. Ellie could sell Louise's hair and give up her Simone de Beauvoir headband. On the other hand, you could ask Emily to entice Louise to La La Land. If none of these work, then there might be one more option. Ask Samuel for bicycles for a speedier advancement. If the beast does notice, you can make it quick to camping. Whatever path you choose to follow, then you're sure to realise that the beast is not as bad as imagined in mind's eye. It's a lot of work to get there, but when all is said and done, the adventure was exciting, and it turned out to be fun. The help your parents gave must not be sold short. They packed your bag with essentials and ensured you had support. Your teachers should be held up as your true and trusty guides. The journey was less treacherous, with them by your side. Moving on from the IB, one extra element I'd like to mention is the grade 12 outing. Teachers versus students firing lasers, there was sure to be some shouting. So grade 12, if there ever comes a moment when you should let someone win, please do remember laser games when the teachers did this very thing. My final word provides vital advice. Act responsibly and kindly, and I'm sure all will be right. In fact, the learner profile attributes may well act as your pendulum light. GEMS is a place we've contributed so much to, and we are fortunate and happy that we made the journey with you. And whilst it is true that this building is global, please do not be, for it is the memories of the people, all the people, that we will forever keep. Thank you.
Pulled in a new direction, but I think I like it.
to the front to make her speech.
First of all, I would like to thank all the parents, students, and staff for coming to our graduation ceremony. This could not have been easy given the circumstances, and as a class, we're deeply grateful. Despite the uncertainty of everyone's futures, we've been overwhelmed with your support. When you come to an establishment like GEMS, you make a contract with the teachers and a contract with the staff. And although we may not be in the most academic of classes, I don't think anyone can dispute our hard work ethic and sense of fun. And this hard work, our hard work, has been easily matched by our teachers. Their dedication and communication has been just incredible. I think that many of us would not have achieved what we have today without your continuous encouragement, enthusiasm, and sheer passion for the subjects you teach. So thank you. We would also like to show our appreciation to the people behind the scenes, be it the security staff, the receptionists, those working at the sports centre, and the canteens, and many more. Without all of you, GEMS wouldn't have had the sense of safety and cheerfulness that it did. During our time here, we have taken part in an eye-opening service trip to Kenya, countless fundraisers, and some very competitive sporting events. I think one of my favourite memories would be watching a students versus staff football game. I think it's safe to say that the students showed no mercy, yet somehow ended up losing. All of this has greatly enhanced our learning experience, bringing our community closer together with every activity. We realise that this is a really difficult time, but we would like to finish this academic year on a high. And we, as Grade 12, wish all the students, teachers and staff the very best of luck for the coming months ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. My first and only experiences at Jan's World Academy Switzerland took place during the diploma program. I found that not only were the teachers and staff welcoming in all their efforts to help me and other students to reach our full potential, but students from all grades made an effort to include us as well. School-wide events such as Intercultural Day and the Group 4 project allowed students at Jan's to support each other regardless of grade or age. This sense of community is extended to all the staff who have much closer relationships with students than some of the schools I have been to before. The teachers at GEMS have gone above and beyond to ensure that both struggling and curious students would have opportunities to learn more outside of classes, often at the cost of their own lunch breaks and free periods. Actions like these and the clear support from the rest of the community are only part of what has made GEMS World Academy Switzerland such a great place to learn at and to attend. As a new student, I'm glad that GEMS was the school I chose to come to and will always be thankful for all the hard work the community has put into helping us succeed. Thank you.
Hello everyone. Let me just say that this was all a little bit last minute, but I'm going to try and speak from the heart, which I hope helps. Change. What a strange concept. The everlasting reminder that things cannot remain exactly as they are now. That things will shift and grow, and one day they might even appear to be completely gone. When things change, the thought of losing our comfort zone and stepping into a space of vulnerability can truly be scary and daunting, and our natural response is to fight back, say no, resist, and refuse to let go. That's okay. If we didn't, we wouldn't exactly be human. However, if there's anything that I've learned in this little life of mine, it's that magic can happen when we allow change to come into our lives. When we let go and let things take on a new shape and form, for the only certainty lies in uncertainty. Deciding to let your life change by having children, like the graduating class of today, creating a life, raising a human, watching them grow, that's magic. Being told you can't do something and having to try something new, only to fall completely and utterly in love with it, finding a new passion, that's magic. Getting turned down for what feels like the job or offer of your dreams, only to realize that real dreams are not material, they lie elsewhere. Realizing what matters, that's magic. Finishing school and starting a new chapter of your life, learning about the world around you and discovering that things are never as they seem, magic. But I've been there, and I'm still there. Change is coming. And if you're anything like me, you might be feeling a little bit scared, lost, or confused. So here are a few things that I have learned and things that I continue to learn that I hope help you, and maybe you, just a little bit. Firstly, take the risk. Whether it be big or small, I promise you will not regret living your life without that persistent, awful what-if feeling. Stop worrying so much. There's only so much you can control, and sometimes relinquishing your power is the most freeing thing you can do. You've made it this far, and I know it's been hard, but I promise that you'll make it through the next few years as well. Meet new people. I cannot stress this enough. Go to the party, say yes to the invite, make new friends, and learn about people's lives. Pearls of wisdom lie in people's stories. So not take advantage of that. And in talking to new people, you learn to see a new side of yourself. You learn to get to know the person that everyone else sees. Get to know the you that you didn't even know existed. In these next few years, challenge yourself and say yes as often as possible. Say yes to any opportunity that makes your heart glow a little. Say yes to growth and say yes to learning. Say yes, and I promise the rest will fall into place. not make money the center of your life. Money comes and goes, and more of it can always be made. The time we spend doing what we love, or the time we get to spend with the people we love, is not guaranteed. Our tomorrow is not guaranteed. Don't waste too much time thinking about money. That being said, please educate yourself on your financial situation. Understand, and I mean really understand your budget. Start saving and ask yourself, do I really need this or do I just want it? If you want it but can't afford it quite yet, wait and save and work towards the goal. Be proactive. Figure out the nitty gritty when it comes to your loans and your taxes and everything in between. And always, always, always have an emergency fund. You never know what can happen. That brings me to the next point, which is things are about to go wrong. You'll find yourself in a position where everything you thought could go wrong does. And you make a plan and you realize, it wasn't actually that bad. Your time will come. Now, I personally believe that that is a myth. Your time is now. It always has been and it always will be now. Life isn't what you will be and what you will achieve. Life is happening all around us, all the time. It's in the feeling of our proud parents' excitement and sadness in their hearts looking at their babies growing up. It's in the buzzing excitement in your heads thinking about what's to come and tonight and the shenanigans that await. It's me talking right now, telling you that you are lucky to be alive and that a lot of people don't get that chance. Do not take it for granted. And please, please, do not let the pressure of the future weigh you down so heavily that you forget to see what's already in front of you. Don't be afraid if you haven't got it all figured out yet. You're not supposed to have all the answers. This little life we have is almost like a Rubik's Cube, and some of us align our colors quickly, some of us take more time, some of us completely change the game, and some of us realize we never wanted to be aligned in the first place. So all in all, yes, change is scary, but it can also be beautiful. It can be life-changing and tough to face, but it enables growth. It makes new space for the better, brighter moments to come. Change is crucial, change is inevitable. But the lessons we learn and the memories we make are invincible. They can never change. I take comfort in knowing that those will stay the same, no matter what happens next. Every single memory we all have of struggling together, laughing together, making mistakes together, growing together, and figuring it out day by day together, all of that will continue to live on inside of us, inside of you, inside the living, limitless walls of friendship and love, and not inside of the four concrete walls of a building.
So first, I would like to call Nicholas Diaz Martins to the stage. Matthews. Michael Carolfi. Leonardo Aquino. Espen Olsen.
Alexandra Radjimova. Lucas Melnight Alvarez. Ellen Reed. Otto Schuster. Felix Schuster. Natasha Smith. Samuel Thompson. This is my last time on the podium, so congrats, grads. Grade 12. For the last time, grade 12. I invite you to take your tassels from the right-hand side and put them over to the left-hand side. Graduates, stand up. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand as well. It is my pleasure to present to you the graduating class of 2019.